Well, good morning again. Turn your Bibles to Genesis chapter 1 this morning. Genesis chapter 1, verse 1. It's interesting to me that when we talk about a creator, the earth being created in six literal days, and that evolution is not true, that it can be a controversial issue. Now, just like we talked about this morning in Sunday school, we're led to believe that we are in the minority. That if you're a creationist, all the PhDs and all the big scientists, they believe in evolution. That's not true. Go to answersingenesis.com. They'll show you all the PhDs and all the folks that believe that there is a creator. And you can see from our theme, we did not come from monkeys. All right? Now, just because you got someone in your family that acts like a monkey, that doesn't mean we come from one. Amen? And so we're going to have some fun today, and this whole month we've been looking at really what it's about is creation and evolution. And I believe today that in four different ways that we can look at, we can understand creation. And I love science. Science is one of my favorite things. And right now we've been hearing a lot about respect the science, right? Respect the science. Well, let me tell you, when it comes to the science of there being a God and a creator, I ask that they respect the science. Amen? When it comes to pro-life and not killing babies in the womb, I say respect the science. And so, but sometimes they like it to go one direction. But let me just go back to, are we in the minority? We are not in the minority of believing that there is a creator. You look at Judaism, Islam, and Christianity. That's a huge population of our planet, all three believing in creation. And then it's fascinating to me that we always think that first world countries were so wise. I don't think we are. Now, on a car, if you look at the battery, it says, do not drink the battery acid. Do you know cars back in the 60s used to tell people how to adjust the valves in the motor? Now it says, do not drink the battery acid. I do not think we're getting smarter. And to me, when you look at all the little jungle people, and when they're out there, you know what, they look around and they go, well, this didn't get here by chance. There had to be a creator. Even they understand there had to be a creator. And so last week, we looked at the human body, the different ways that our body shows that there is a designer. Do you know that your heart is actually two pumps in one? Your body had to figure out, if evolution was true, your body had to figure out how to pump your blood pressure 9 times higher to your body, but then lower it 9 times to your lungs. If your heart pumped the same pressure throughout your entire body, you know what it would do? It would kill you. And so when you study the human body and the brain, and you see how complex the brain is, the synapses that you have, the neurons that you have, how many hundreds of billions and millions there are, it's absolutely unbelievable. When you study the human eye and why it would have developed slowly when it would never work until it is complete, it would have never worked. How that all came together is very interesting and all points to a designer. Look at Genesis chapter 1 this morning. Today we're going to look at animals. What do we see when we study animals? Do we see a creator or do we see evolution? Let me just touch on this real quick. Do you know what my favorite thing that prove evolution is? The tweeners. We call them tweeners. That's the in-between fossils. We have fossil records of many species, but we have zero of one species turning into another species. Even in the Smithsonian, and you look up there and they show the graph it looks like a ape-like creature, or chimpanzee-like creature, and it stands up taller and taller, more erect until it gets to a human. And do you know what fossils we have of that? Monkeys and us. That's it. There's not one that's been found in between. Every time it's been disproved, it was either rickets that transferred their bones and deformed their bones. Lucy, we've already been found. We know what Lucy comes from. And so if you want to learn about that, and you can see my message from last Sunday. But look at Genesis chapter 1, verse 1 this morning. It says, in the beginning God created the heaven and the earth. And the earth was without form and void, and darkness was upon the face of the deep, and the Spirit of God moved upon the face of the waters. And God said, let there be light, and there was light. And God saw that the light, saw that it was good. And God divided the light from the darkness, and God called the light day, and the darkness he called night, and the evening and the morning were the first day. And God said, let there be a firmament in the midst of the waters, and let it divide the waters from the waters. And God made the firmament and divided the waters which were under the firmament from the waters which were above the firmament, and it was so. And God called the firmament heaven, and the evening and the morning were the second day. And God said, let the waters under the heaven be gathered together unto a place, and let dry land appear, and it was so. And God called the dry land earth, and the gathering together of the waters called the seas, and God saw that it was good. And God said, let the earth bring forth grass, and the herb yielding seed, and the fruit tree yielding fruit after his kind. Now, I touched on this last Sunday. You're going to see that a lot here. It produces its kind. We had cows thousands of years ago. They've made cows. Do you know what cows make today? Cows. Verse 13, in the evening and the morning were the third day. Verse 14, and God said, let there be lights in the firmament of heaven, and divided the day from the night, and let them be for signs and for seasons and for days and years, and let them be for lights in the firmament of heaven to give light upon the earth, and it was so. And God made two great lights, the greater light to rule the day and the lesser light to rule the night, and he made the stars also. I always love that. It's like P.S. Without any effort, God made the stars also. I love it. Look at verse 19, the evening and morning were the fourth day. Verse 20, and God said, let the waters bring forth abundantly the moving creature that hath life, and the fowl that it may fly above the earth and the open firmament of heaven. And God created great whales and every living creature that moveth, which the waters brought forth abundantly after their kind, and every winged fowl after his kind. And God saw that it was good, and God blessed them, saying, be fruitful and multiply and fill the waters with seas, and let the fowl multiply the earth. And the evening and morning were the fifth day. Verse 24, and God said, let the earth bring forth the living creature after his kind, cattle and creeping thing, and the beasts of the earth after his kind. And it was so. And God made the beasts of the earth after his kind, and the cattle after their kind, and everything that creepeth upon the earth after his kind. And God saw that it was good. That it was good. Let's take a minute and let's pray. Heavenly Father, we thank you for today. We thank you for your many blessings. I ask that you give me clarity of speech and thought this morning. Speak to our hearts and minds. And Lord, I pray if there's one here that doesn't know you as their Lord and Savior, that today would be that day. In Jesus' name, amen. First thing before we really get started, we have to understand the difference between microevolution and macroevolution. Microevolution is observable. It's repeatable. We can test it. We can prove it. We know that it is a fact. I don't know how true this is, but I heard that 125 years ago, we did not have 80% of the dog breeds that we have today. Now, I think that number is a lot different because now we got Yorkie poos and teacup everything and doodles on everything. So I don't know how many species there are today, but that is microevolution. But do you know what those dogs are? They're dogs. Do you know what they produce? Dogs. That's right. That's it. Now let's look at a species here. When we look at animals and design, look at the woodpecker. Okay, go to the next slide. Look at the woodpecker up here. That's not the woodpecker. That's the walking branch. We'll talk about that in camouflage. Let me just give you some ideas here about the woodpecker. That's not the woodpecker either. You don't got my woodpecker on there? Of his brain and his tongue? Well, I apologize. So let me just tell you a little bit about the woodpecker. I believe the woodpecker absolutely shows design. When a hole is drilled, the woodpecker uses extremely long tongue, which can be up to 6 inches, to reach inside and grab insects. Okay, at the end of the tongue, there are bristles like a brush that grab them. Now, that doesn't mean too much, does it? That's not too much. Let me just continue. The woodpecker slams its tree, or it's not its tree, its head into the tree a dozen times per second. At impact, the sudden deceleration produces a force many times the bird's total body weight. So literally many times beyond its entire body weight. So if I weigh 200 pounds, all right, maybe a little more. Imagine that force, me slamming into a tree many times the force of my body. It would kill me. So a woodpecker can do that, so for a human being, it would absolutely be fatal. How does a woodpecker survive? It has a whole suit design that works together to protect the woodpecker's brain. For example, their upper and lower beaks are actually differ slightly in length and density. Okay? The longer beak changes shape on impact just before the stronger beak takes a hit. So already that force begins to be absorbed and to be, pushed throughout the rest of the body. This 1-2 punch redirects the force of the collision downward away from the woodpecker's brain. Scientists estimate that it almost 90% of the force is removed just by the beak. Now let's talk about the woodpecker's tongue. The woodpecker's tongue splits into two different ways, which run on both sides of its neck, then wrap around the entire skull. Every time the beak strikes a tree, the tongue tightens against what's called the jugular vein, even restricts how much blood flow how much blood can flow out of the brain. The mechanism momentarily increases the cushion of blood stored between the brain and the skull. The woodpecker's brain cavity is also compact, giving the brain less room to move around. You know, our brains can actually move around. It's how you get a concussion, okay? So think about this. A woodpecker sees a tree, and he sees there's bugs in there, and he starts pecking on that tree, and he knocks himself stupid or kills himself. Now, how does he go? You know what? If I could get my tongue to wrap around my brain, if I could get there be less room inside my cavity of my brain, I would stop killing myself. And if I could somehow get my beak to absorb that throat, that would keep me from killing myself. That'd be a real good idea. Now, real quick, let's talk about Darwin's finches. Do you know what Darwin's finches still make today? Finches. So again, we're talking about difference of micro and macroevolution. Microevolution is a bird can be born with a stronger beak and realize that, hey, I can eat different nuts that other birds may not eat. Okay, that is microevolution. It's observable, it's repeatable, it's provable. Macroevolution is one species turning into a completely different species. Of the fossil record, we do not have one single fossil out of the thousands that we have. Now let's continue. Let's look at another animal. The giraffe. To send sufficient oxygen all the way to the brain, the giraffe's lungs are 8 times larger than a human's. The giraffe also has one of the longest tail of land animals today. It's nearly 8 feet long. I did not realize. I thought their tail was pretty little by looking at it, but it's not. On average, giraffes sleep about 2 hours a day. So that's not a lot, but let's look at it. But today, greater understanding of heredity. We know that the giraffe with a stretched neck from reaching wouldn't pass on characteristics of its offspring. So a lot of times people would say, well, it will pass off its traits to its offsprings, and we'll explain that and why that would not take place of the characteristics that the giraffe has today. So Jean Lamarck and later Charles Darwin proposed that a giraffe evolved a long neck by inheriting traits acquired through uses and disuse. Darwin thought a drought could have led to early giraffes needing to stretch their necks to reach leaves in the treetops. But today, through greater understanding of heredity, we know that a giraffe with a stretched neck for reaching wouldn't pass on that characteristic to its offspring. A modified idea suggests that the long neck evolved through mutation and natural selection, which favored those giraffes that could reach higher branches. Such idea raises the question, what did the younger giraffes eat before they got that tall? They would have died. And why do giraffes, even today, often eat at shoulder height and below? More importantly, the proposed progression of short to long neck giraffes is absolutely absent from the fossil record. There is no fossil record of a giraffe's neck getting longer and longer and longer and longer. Nowhere. We have not one. Evolutionists also encounter a design dilemma for the evolution of a long neck. The 6-foot neck requires what are called intricate blood vessels to maintain proper blood pressure between the heart and the brain. A giraffe bending its neck down to drink water is a marvelous display of design. For a giraffe to be able to drink water is absolutely proving design. Listen at this. The 25-pound heart that pumps blood way up that neck against gravity suddenly pumps down and with gravity, which would cause its brain to explode. So if a giraffe did not have the intricate valves, it would literally blow its brains out. So what giraffe bent down and drank a drink of water, said, I just blew my brains out, I need intricate valves? But the blood vessels are uniquely designed with reinforced walls, bypass valves, and a cushioning web, and six sensor signals to moderate the pressure when the giraffe bends its neck down. The reverse of the intricate system happens when the giraffe raises its head. This is incredible. You ever bend down and stand up too fast? Imagine that much blood pressure that a giraffe has. It has to be able to control that so it literally doesn't pass out in its head, so that the pressure of the regained, as it's regained, the giraffe doesn't pass out. And in addition, the tight skin on the giraffe legs have been compared to an astronaut's G-suit because it prevents high blood pressure from pressing blood out of the capillaries. So literally, a giraffe is absolutely pointing to design because it could not function and live because it cannot slowly have these things come into place. It would have to have it all at once. How many giraffes blew their brains to pieces when bending down, and how many passed out when they lift their heads and became food for lions until special features somehow evolved? It's obvious that the very first giraffes had to have these special features right from the beginning. Let me just give you a little side note here, a little rabbit trail. When we look at kids' drawings of giraffes on the ark and their heads sticking out of the ark, that is not accurate in any way. Stop showing that to your kids. Okay? Do you know why? Because when non-believers look at these things and they see a giraffe with its head sticking out of the ark, they go, that's really highly improbable, and that almost causes kids to believe that and question that. When Noah went on the ark, do you think he took fully grown animals, or wouldn't it make a lot more sense if he took adolescent, very young? It'd be a lot easier to care for a lion cub than it would a full-grown lion, right? Less water needed, less food needed, less waste produced, everything. Now let's talk about the bombardier beetle. This dude's one of my favorites. The bombardier beetle. Okay? I've met some men that could produce some things that would cause people to run away, but the bombardier beetle takes it all. And listen, I know today's a little bit different in my preaching, but it's looking at this information. You know, as a pastor, now I have to be proficient in science. I got to be proficient in history. I can't just preach the Bible. Many pastors back in the day didn't have to worry about these things because when people looked out, they saw that there was a designer. So let's talk about this. This beetle is called the bombardier beetle because it ejects with an actual audible popping sound, a hot, highly noxious spray of aqueous, oxygen and steam as a defense mechanism against predators. The secretion's very accurately delivered between twin sets of spray nozzles located at the tip of the beetle's abdomen and most effective at stunning predators, even mammals such as mice, thus allowing the beetle space to run away and get away. How did the beetle accidentally produce the chemicals that would react? How did it accidentally have the two right chemicals in its body that would produce the popping sound, propel it away? How did it accidentally figure out how to deliver the chemicals at the exact right time to cause a chemical reaction? How did it accidentally keep the chemicals separated, thus not blowing itself up? It had to have a designer. Let's talk about another one that's pretty interesting. The whip scorpion has a chemical containing the whip scorpion, which tells predators to bug off before they even try to eat it, has a built-in nozzle at the base of the tail, which aims and fires at a threat like a cannon, a mace. The spray combines two chemicals, which work together. Think about the spitting cobra. How did the cobra figure out that if I have these chemicals in my body, I can spray this venom, and that venom will even be effective? How did poisonous animals even figure out that through these poisons, this will save my life, make me flee? Warning coloration you'll see on there. How did the yellow jacket and these different species figure out that if I have these colors on me, it will let other animals know that I'm poisonous and that I'll kill them? Yellow jackets, they have bold yellow and black colors to warn enemies away. Bright coloring often goes hand in hand with defensive chemicals. The creature's body serves as a billboard warning would-be predators about the dangers of poisoning. Now think about this. Think about snakes that are not poisonous but have coloration of poisonous snakes. How did they figure out, or through apps, not even figure out, through absolute random processes, have the exact colors to match up, maybe in a different order? What is it? Red, black, and yellow, kill a fellow. I forget the other one, something. I don't know. It's not Sailor's Delight. That's something to do with rain. I don't know. But anyways, to go, you know what, if I have these colors, I'll just scare my predators away because they'll think that I'm a different species and that I'm dangerous. Now think about this. Camouflage refers to color patterns, behaviors, and shapes that God designed to allow creatures to match its surroundings, making it very difficult for predators to see them. At Cedarville University, Becca Book, Pensacola Christian College are good examples. They talk about the walking stick. As its name implies, it looks like a stick and is almost indistinguishable from its surrounding twigs. The joints and seams on its legs match the pattern of smaller twigs and branches to larger ones throughout their body. It also walks slow, wobbly, halting strides that mimic the general sway of slender branches. Camouflage in insects. How did that come about? Through random processes for a species to perfectly match its surroundings. Camouflaged insects, all kinds of tree hoppers. They look like thorns. You have the dead leaf butterfly, folds its wing back. It looks like a dead leaf. How? Startling displays. We have species. You have the Prometheus moth flashes their eye spots, and it startles predators and causes them to run away. It's fascinating. How did a moth, through random processes, end up with large eyed spots on the back of its wings that when it knows that it opens them up when predators are there and that causes them to flee? Let's talk about playing dead. How did an animal figure out through natural reactions in its body? It doesn't just fall over, and as its brain, things happen in the body of many animals that cause them to play dead, even produce smells. Then talking about self-cutting. Insects play dead. Then we look at that little lizard doodle dude there. How did his body, through random processes, go, you know what, if I could lose my tail, I'll be able to get away, I'll still stay alive and not die, and I won't bleed out? How did those things happen? It's too sophisticated for random mutations. We see a designer everywhere we look. And please don't think that just the animals I've talked today is the only ones. I barely scratched the surface of all the animals that absolutely don't just say that there's a designer. They scream that there is a designer. The defense mechanisms of just about every group in the animal kingdom can provide us with a lifetimes of different things to study and to see that many times over and over they're too sophisticated and too complex that it could have ever come about through random processes and mutations. Secondly, there's not one single fossil record that has ever shown the step-by-step process of a giraffe's neck getting longer. There's no example of one fossil record species ever showing one animal turning into another animal. I don't know about you. If you've ever seen any of the Jurassic Park movies, I do not believe the fossil raptors said, you know what, we're going to survive better if we turn into a chicken. Okay? Everywhere we look screams that there is a designer. And it is to say that there is not a God and that that evolution is the way to go is an absolute rejection of science of every capacity. Our human body absolutely screams that there is a designer. Our animals, as we look around through our earth. Now next week we'll be talking about planets. The planets and the stars, and how do they show a designer or do they show a creator? They absolutely show a creator. What drives me nuts when it comes to atheists, they often say, respect the science and look at the science, but Uranus and Venus actually show that their science is incorrect. And you know what they do? Every single time they look at a planet and it doesn't do what it's supposed to do, you know what they say? It got hit by something. Why doesn't it rotate this way? It got hit by something. It's not as dense as it should be. It got hit by something. It's more dense than it should be. It got hit by something. Every single time, that's what they say. It got hit by something. I don't know if you're familiar with Richard Dawkins. He's a very intelligent man. He is a staunch atheist. Do you know what he come out and he said? Life is too complex. There had to be a creator. Do you know what he said the creator was? Aliens. Now you tell me who has more faith, or who takes more faith to believe. To me, I don't have enough faith to be an atheist. Exactly. And if they're more complex than we are, then they even screams there's a designer at some point. So today, when I discuss these things, what's the point of this? To me, the point of it is to give you education and understanding that when we read God's word, we can have confidence in knowing and understanding that it's true. This morning we discussed the Bible and how can we know that the Bible is true and it's been translated and all these different things and 40 different men. And you know what? When I look at there was 40 different men that wrote the Bible, to me that's a miracle within itself. They didn't know each other. Some never, they didn't know even the other one even existed. They were hundreds of miles apart. How could the Bible be accurate and true? We looked at out of the 2,500 prophecies mentioned in the Bible, 2,000 have been fulfilled. They've all been proven accurate. Do you know every time the Bible has been proven accurate scientifically, even scientifically, the Bible's always been accurate? The book of Isaiah and Job talk about the earth sits on nothing, talks about the earth being round. Do you know, and I'm being nice when I say that was 500 years before scientists ever figured out that the earth was round. How did the authors know those things to even put them down? How would they know that and understand those things? You know, the Bible talks about the pathways in the oceans. That's how that was discovered. The guy that figured that out, that there are pathways in our oceans, found it from God's word. That's where he found it and figured it out. You know, the Bible's been accurate every time historically. There was a group called the Hittites, powerful nation. For years, historians said, we know that the Bible's not accurate because the Hittites never existed. Do you know what they found around 1908, I believe? You know what they found? They found the ruins of the Hittite Empire. There was a guy by the name of Belteshazzar, not Belteshazzar with a T, that's Daniel. Daniel was his Babylonian name. Belteshazzar was a king. He was related to Daniel for years. They said, you know what? The Bible's not accurate. We found a mistake. Belteshazzar did not exist. Do you know what they found? They found cylinders, and it listed all these kings and all these great rulers and went around, and guess whose name was on there? Belteshazzar. The Bible has always been found to be accurate every single time through history. It does not contain one contradiction. It'll teach you every facet of your life, how to be a father, how to be a mother, how to be a husband, how to be a wife, how to be a child. Anything you want to desire to do, you can go to God's word and you can see. If you would, go ahead and stand with me this morning. If you're going to be baptized this morning, let's just start. If you're just going to be baptized up here, go change your clothes. If you're getting baptized in the pond, you can wait just a few minutes before you go. Now listen, I don't say all this information and give you all these facts just so you can get on Facebook and be like, you know what, atheists are idiots. No. I give you all these facts and all this information so that you can provoke thought, so that people can be free thinkers and have thought and study and look at information for themselves. So you can study and you can look and bring up things and cause them to have that wonder, to study on their own and to look at things for their own. Remember, if you win the argument but lose the soul, then you've lost everything. We're not here to yell and scream and argue with everybody. But you know what? We as believers, I found, we've bought into this ideology of you can't talk religion. You're not supposed to talk religion to everybody. Well, then we got one side, they're yelling as loud as they can, and we've went quiet on it. What we need to be doing is talking about these things and provoking conversations between people and giving answers. Giving answers. The Bible says to give an answer for the hope that is in you. Give an answer. I want us to be strong in our faith and understanding that anywhere we look in the Bible that we can know that it's accurate and that it's true. I would encourage you this morning, if you don't know for sure that heaven will be your home, today needs to be the day that you get saved. You're going to see people get baptized, and what that is, that's a picture of the death, burial, and resurrection of Christ, and that's going to show us, and they're making it public, that they have accepted Christ as their Lord and Savior, and they want the world to know they want to live for Jesus. Amen? And we're going to see all ages, and I love it. I'm excited about it. But this morning, if you're thinking, I don't know for sure, heaven will be your home, I'll be up here, I'll wait on you. If you want to get saved today, you come up here, we'll pray with you, and you can know for sure that when you die, you'll go to heaven. That can be known. 1 John 5:12 says that you may know that you have eternal life. It's not conditional life. It didn't say you can know you have conditional life. It says so that you can know that you have eternal life. And you know what? If you've maybe, you know what? I've accepted Christ, but I haven't really been living for God. I haven't been reading my Bible. I haven't been in prayer. I haven't been going to church. I haven't been doing anything. Today's the day to pray and rededicate yourself. And then I'll ask, thirdly, if you're here, you know you're going to heaven, you know you're saved, and you've been living for the Lord, I'd like to ask you to just come forward and just pray for everybody else. Just come to the altar and pray for everybody else. If you're not familiar, this is what we're going to do. I'm going to say a short prayer. When I say amen, we have a nice pad here to kneel down and pray. We're going to open that up, and you can come and pray, and we can speak to the Lord and allow Him to speak to your hearts. Let's pray. Heavenly Father, we love You so much. We thank You for everything that You've done for us. Lord, I ask that You bless this time of invitation. We praise You and love You. In Jesus' name, amen. Let's pray this morning. been great to be in the Lord's house. Amen. You know, what it really comes down to when we study these things is I want you to understand there's a God that loves you and He cares about you. I mentioned this last week, and I'll mention it again. When we first moved to London, there was an 11-year-old girl who had taken her own life. And the only thing I think about all the time is just what if she knew there was a God that loved her and cared about her. That she didn't come from monkeys. There was a God that designed her. There was thought, and there was care and love that was put into creating her. And I think that's the message that we've got to get out. This today, I hope, just empowers you to get that message out. But that's the message we've got to carry. Amen. If you would, you may be seated. Those that are going to be baptized. What? Oh, yeah. All right. If you guys want to make your way up here. Richard, if you'd like to make your way up here, and we'll do Brian first. Okay. Now, I want to give you a little background history about this fellow right here. Okay? How long did it take you to get here, brother?
5 hours.
5 hours. 5 hours. How long had you been working on Brian to get saved?
12 years.
12 years.
He's a hard-headed.
Don't worry, brother. We got a lot of hard-headed people in our church. We're used to it. Listen, who have you been working on for 12 years to get saved? Who, if they got saved, would call you up and say, I got to tell you, I trusted Jesus today? And if they were getting baptized, would want you to come to their baptism, and you would drive 5 hours to come baptize them. Brian, we'll have you come up here first.
Can I say something?
Yes, sir.
Never give up.
That's right. Never give up.
I'm 86 years old, and God's still working.
That's right.
Never give up.
That's right.
And this guy's a blessing to me.
Amen. I'll set this about right here.
Okay.
And Richard, you'll be on this side, and Brian, we'll have you come over there. I need more cloths, Lacey. All right. So if you'll step in here, so you'll step here, and then you can step down there, and you'll just sit down right there.
Is there a weight limit on this
thing? No, sir. You're not even close. Amen.
We're going to come over the top.
That's all right. We'll come over a little bit. That's all right. Okay. So this is what we'll do here, Brian. You'll just cross your arms a little bit over your body. Okay. And then I'm going to take this. I'll put this over your face. Kind of hold your nose for you a little bit. And then we'll lay you back. And then we'll bring you right back up. Okay. So, Brian, have you accepted Jesus Christ as your Lord and Savior?
Yes.
Is it your desire to live from Him, especially from this day forward?
Yes.
All right. Brian, I baptize you in the name of God the Father, Son, and the Holy Ghost, buried in the likeness of Christ's death, raised in the likeness of His resurrection. Walk in newness of life. It's right there, brother. Who's next? Come on up here. Right there. Amen.
I didn't want to come after you.
Are you ready? Let me come around here. I'll help you out a little bit. That's all right. Let me get Rob, come up here. Well, hold on just a minute, and let me get some help up here.
Okay.
Rob, if you'll stay up here with me and hold people's towels for me. You gotta quit. You're making me laugh too much. You gotta quit. We're supposed to be serious right now, and you got me laughing. All right, go ahead and have a seat. We'll make it quick. We'll make it quick. Okay. Just put your hands across your chest. Okay. Helen, have you accepted Jesus as your Lord and Savior?
Yes, and I think I've been baptized before. I just don't remember.
Helen, is it your desire to live for Jesus from this day forward?
I do all the time. I pray. I should have. Never mind.
Amen. All right. Helen, it's my privilege to baptize you as my sister in the name of God the Father, Son, and the Holy Ghost, buried in the likeness of Christ. Raise the likeness of resurrection. Yeah, you are wet. That's true.
I feel like a. Don't you back there be taking pictures. I gotta get out of here.
Okay. So we're gonna help you.
Right.
Let me move it a little closer to you.
I could have been a little bit
skinnier.
Yeah,
put your foot. That's all right. You're okay.
Well,
don't slip on the floor. You got one more step to go down.
Just give me time. I'm
old. You're okay. All right. Who's next?
Everybody see me drown.
and then we'll help Marilyn. Okay. And then he'll hold your towel for you, Marilyn. Yeah. Yeah, so you'll step on here, and then you can step right down there, okay? Well, it feels good to me, but I don't have to be in it. She wants you to. As you sit down, that's right. We like to make it a fun experience.
Yeah.
Hi, I'm Miss Marilyn. You'll just put your hands across like this. Okay. Marilyn, have you accepted Jesus Christ as your Lord and Savior?
Yes.
Is it your desire to live from Him from this day forward? Okay. Marilyn, it's my privilege to baptize you as my sister in the name of God the Father and the Son and the Holy Ghost, buried in the likeness of Christ, raised in the likeness of His resurrection. Amen. Just take your time. You want to step up there? Okay. That's no problem. All right. Well, we got a couple more coming. All right. Your arms. Whew. Try not to cry on this one. I got you, buddy. I'll take good care of you. Logan, have you accepted Jesus Christ, your Lord and Savior?
Yes.
Well, Logan, it's my privilege to baptize you as my brother in the name of God the Father, the Son, and the Holy Ghost, buried in the likeness of Christ, raised in the likeness of His resurrection. If you cry, I'm going to cry. Yeah, I was going to cry. I can't help it. All right, George, you ready, buddy? you guys even know half of what they were saying up here, you'd be dying laughing with us.
Now you know I don't wear shorts.
Oh, man, George.
Till the last bubble comes up.
Oh. All right, George, cross your arms. George, have you accepted Jesus Christ as your Lord and Savior?
Yes.
Amen. Is it your desire to live from Him, especially from this day forward?
Yes.
And George, it's my privilege to baptize you as my brother in the name of God the Father, the Son, and the Holy Ghost, buried in the likeness of Christ's death, raised in the likeness of His resurrection. You're the last one for up here.
Oh, were we going to do one in the pond, too?
And then we got pond ones coming up.
Okay.
Well, amen. That's a fun day, amen? Well, we're going to keep it going. I'm excited. I'm going to say a prayer. Well, I'm not going to pray because the service ain't over. We got a pond that's back there, and some people want to get baptized in it. And I said, we don't care, we'll dunk you. Amen? And so if you have trouble walking, just pull your car in the grass close to the pond. That's okay. And we still have quite a few people that want to get baptized, and so we're going to the pond. It's a great time. Amen? It's going to be a lot of fun. So no prayer because the service ain't over. Let's head to the pond.